Well, welcome to everyone for our monthly seminar. And I can assure you, we continue to aspire to a world without nuclear weapons. But I think it's also very important that we hear about the work going on, in fact, to maintain our weapons as safe and reliable on the pathway to our aspiration. So today, as you know, we have Jill Hruby as our speaker. But let me start by saying that Jill is spending a year here at MIT. At MIT. it's a seminar.
So where am I?
I revert into my mode of 40 plus years. So at NTI, Jill is our inaugural Distinguished Fellow, and specifically the Sam Nunn Distinguished Fellow. This is a program that we're just kicking off. Again, Jill is our first Distinguished Fellow. And our idea is quite simply to be able to bring in, on kind of a term basis, these people who don't want to make long-term commitments, but a year is good, to come in and bring fresh ideas, hopefully benefit from interacting with all of us, but really give us new ideas. And I can say that having the first fellow kind of set the bar is really important. We have set the bar nice and high, and Jill has certainly been a most welcome member of our family, of our activities here, and is doing a terrific job. And maybe in November, she will be able to give another seminar on some of the products of our efforts here. But today, as you know, she will be talking about largely drawing upon, I guess, previous experience, although still engaged. Let me just say that Jill was at Sandia for 34 years. In 34 years, as you can imagine, kind of covered a lot of waterfronts there, starting out in the honest work of the materials and engineering sciences, and then eventually getting into administration, which I will not characterize as you know I would, because I've been there, done that. But really working in energy, non-proliferation, homeland security, nuclear security, defense systems, and of course, the nuclear weapons program. And in particular, she was director until May of 2017. And as she will discuss, and I will not discuss now, but I reserve the right to complain later on, from my perspective, what was the required annual nuclear certification process for the stockpile once we went into the non-testing regime and science-based stockpile stewardship. So again, I will not describe the process yet and see how Jill does that. She's had many, many awards. I'm not going to go through them, but again, in the theme of starting out with real work, an actual R&D 100 awardee, and then progressing to Department of Energy, NNSA, Distinguished Service Medals, and very importantly, the Secretary of Defense Distinguished or Exceptional Public Service Award. And most of all, most important of all, 2017, Business Insider named her the second most powerful female engineer. This sets up the obvious first question that I will ask in the Q&A. With that, Jill, welcome.
I want to say two things. Sam is on the phone. He's muted, but he's listening in. So if he has questions, he already actually got a sort of a preview. And secondly, Ernie, thanks for the invite to spend the next year at MIT.
Well, that can follow on this.
So,
Jill, if I could I say one word?
Of course.
Welcome to everyone. I wish I could be there in person, but I had the great privilege of getting this briefing, and all of you who, like me, have worried for a long time about accidents and blunders in the nuclear field will be greatly comforted when you see the outline of the great care that Sandia and Jill and others in the laboratory business have taken over the years to make our nuclear weapons safe, secure, and reliable. I used to worry a great deal when Charlie Curtis was in charge and when Ernie was in charge of the Department of Energy, but now that I know who was really in charge, I feel better retroactively. So welcome. Welcome, and I know we all look forward to hearing from Jill.
Thanks, Sam.
This used to be the Sam Nunn Distinguished Fellow.
So what I'd really like to do today is talk to you about the process that is used at the laboratories and why to certify safe, secure, reliable weapons. I had originally put "and more" because I thought I could tell you all sorts of things, but in reality, trying to get through safe, secure, and reliable certification process starting at 5 in the evening is enough. So if you have other questions about the "and more," feel free to ask at the end. So just a teeny bit of state setting, there are three laboratories in the United States who exist for the primary purpose of designing our nation's nuclear weapons. Those three laboratories are Los Alamos, Lawrence Livermore, and Sandia. Los Alamos and Lawrence Livermore are peer competitor nuclear explosive design pack. They design the nuclear explosives package. Their technical workforce consists mostly of physicists who do that. And that is, you know, a long-standing way that we assure the physics are peer-reviewed. Sandia is an engineering laboratory. It does the weaponization or all the non-nuclear components of nuclear weapons in support of both Lawrence Livermore and Los Alamos designs. And as a result, its primary campus is in Albuquerque, New Mexico, but it also has a campus across the street from Lawrence Livermore in Livermore, California. I need to say that these laboratories in general don't do nuclear weapon production, don't produce materials. That's done at other sites that the NNSA manages. And these are some sort of facts and figures about the size of the laboratories. But as you can see, they're very significant laboratories, and together they make up a good portion of the overall national laboratory complex in the U.S. There are 17 labs, but these are big. So why do we do assessment? What is it all about? Bill Clinton actually started the process of doing assessments when he signed the nuclear test ban. He's asked, and it got codified in law, that the head of each national security laboratory and the commander of STRATCOM annually assess the safety, reliability, performance, or military effectiveness, as the case may be, of the nuclear weapons stockpile. So every year, we spend time, significant amount of time, and I'll explain this to you, to make sure that we deliver on this legal requirement to assess the, and in our case, I should just say the commander of STRATCOM assesses the military effectiveness. The laboratory directors assess the safety, reliability, and at some level, reliability and performance are quite related. Oh, I should say, we submit these letters to our respective secretaries. So the three lab directors to the Secretary of Energy, therefore Ernie will correct me when we finish about how he sees the process. These, they're called letters, but they're really reports. They're, you know, reasonably lengthy documents that we submit. The secretaries then write a letter summarizing this to the president and attach unrevised the letters from the lab directors. That's part of the law. So the lab director's assessment has to contain a certain number of things. Here's what they are. I'll say them very briefly. Safety, reliability, and performance of every weapon in the stockpile for which his, I added her, by the way, his or her laboratory has full or partial responsibility. The adequacy of the science-based tools for the assessment, the adequacy of the manufacturing infrastructure to fix any inadequacy. There is the readiness for underground testing, since this initiated with the ban on underground testing. And we also are required to have independent reviews and red teams that we have to address their findings. So let me just spend a second on this chart on here, because it's an important backdrop to this process at this point in time. So when this process started in 1995, the average age of weapons in the stockpile was about 10, the average age. Today, the average age of weapons in the stockpile is over 25. Weapons are designed for a protected life of usually 25 years, sometimes 20, but 20 to 25 years. So when the average age is over the protected life, all of these weapons have been now in the stockpile over what they were intended, how they were designed. So that makes the annual assessment process pretty important, because in fact, they're outside their age limit. And well, I'll talk more about what that means. In addition, this is the best case scenario because this average age is reset on this chart to zero when something's refurbished. And of course, when a weapon is refurbished, you could argue whether it was new or not, but for this chart, it was considered new. So I want to set this up by just talking about why do we care? So I'll go through this for the different elements. So with respect to safety, there are, as you well know, been real-world safety incidents with nuclear weapons. We tend to refer to these as broken arrows. And I'm not going to describe all of the accidents, but there are two that I think are really pretty illustrative of the kinds of accidents that can occur. The first one is the accident that occurred as part of Operation Chrome Dome, which it was called at the time, over Palomera, Spain. So interestingly, in the 1960s, the United States flew B-52s. They had B-52s with nuclear weapons on them in the air at all times in three different routes. There was a route over Alaska. There was a route over Greenland, and there was a route over Europe. In the route over Europe, called the Southern Route, there was a refueling accident where the B-52 carrying the nuclear weapons hit the refueling pipe, whatever that thing is called, and the refueling aircraft blew up, and the B-52 lost the weapons, and there were four. One landed in the sea, three landed on land, one deployed a parachute. The parachute deployed weapon and the weapon that landed in the sea are shown here. They look a little dented, but otherwise pretty much intact. The one in the sea lost its fins and a few other things. The two that landed on the land scattered plutonium, did not produce any nuclear yield, but the plutonium was scattered. This was a very, very public incident because you had to clean up the plutonium, and it took about 2.5 months to find the weapon that landed in the sea. So this really got the public's attention about nuclear safety. The other incident, which is a completely different type, most of the broken arrows are, in fact, aircraft issues of one sort or another. But there was a missile silo incident called the Damascus incident, which is a story told in Command and Control, which many of by Eric Foster that many of you may have read. In this accident, in a Titan missile silo in Arkansas, a technician dropped a socket from a wrench, a large socket, hit the fuel tank, and there was a fuel leak that eventually resulted in a fuel explosion and the missile and the warhead on that missile being ejected from the silo. It's a scary incident because the warhead was a 9 megaton warhead, and you know, quite old. And so, but the safety features did prevent nuclear material dispersal and nuclear explosion in that incident. But again, it sort of scared the public and scared those of us in the business. So let me just talk about what's been done as a result of those incidents and ones like them. So the modern, let's talk about the modern safety theme. So first I want to say this, the airborne alert Operation Chrome Dome was discontinued as a result of this incident. And then Carl Walski, who's shown here getting a medal, was asked to develop safety criteria. Carl Walski was the, today we would call this person the Assistant Secretary of NCB, the predecessor organization. So he was asked to develop criteria, and the criteria he developed are the criteria we still use today, that there needs to be a 1 in a billion probability during normal operation that over the lifetime of a weapon that it could produce accidental yield. And accidental yield is defined as anything greater than 4 pounds of TNT. I'm not positive about the 4 pounds of TNT, but I think it's what people that were riding in the aircraft could live through if it happened in an aircraft. 1 in a million probability during an accident scenario. So 1 in a billion normal, 1 in a million in an accident scenario. In addition, that the nuclear package had to be had to have 1 point safety, meaning that if there was energy that came in at 1 point on the nuclear explosive package, it would not go off. For each weapon, the normal and abnormal environment is described in the DoD documents about that weapon. It's called military characteristic documents. So the way that the safety themes to satisfy the Walski criteria were developed, and the one I'm going to talk about specifically because Sandia is enhanced nuclear detonation safety. It's also sometimes called enhanced electrical isolation. Also, by starting to use insensitive high explosives, with which Lawrence Livermore and Los Alamos were largely responsible for, and fire-resistant pits that they were also responsible for. So just, this is a pretty geeky thing, but let me just tell you a little bit of how you get 1 in a million or 1 in a billion. So there are electrical mechanical devices that Sandia designs and that are called strong links. Those strong links are essentially switches that hold off electrical energy. So what happens is the nuclear package and a firing set is in an exclusion region. That exclusion region is both a structural barrier and a Faraday cage. And we don't want any energy in that. It's important not to have any energy if you don't want the nuclear package to go off. So we have some strong links that we put in front of that. And if only if the strong links actuate will energy enter into the exclusion region. And in order to get 1 in a million and 1 in a billion, we need 3 strong links, each of which are good to 1 in 1,000. And so one of those strong links is actuated when the code, the famous code is entered into the weapon. So it says there's a human intent that this weapon will be used. And here's the proper code. When the weapon receives the proper code, it turns that code into a very complex signal, a unique signal that we believe cannot be generated naturally. The second strong link is closed if the weapon, once deployed, has a trajectory that's expected. So it senses the trajectory. If it says this is the right trajectory for this weapon, it generates another unique code that closes that strong link. So these two close, and then there's one additional strong link that says both of these close, I'm going to close too. And each of these are qualified So these, the intense strong link and the trajectory strong link are qualified in abnormal environments. So you get 10 to the minus 6 or 1 in a million. All of them are qualified for normal environments, so you get 1 in a billion. So that's the modern safety theme called ENDS that's used in today's weapons. There's just one additional thing that in a fire environment, there are so-called weak links in this. So the weak links will melt and make the weapon inoperable. Literally, there are materials that will melt and make the weapon inoperable before anything else can happen. So those are a very complicated race. These things happen very quickly to make sure the weapon can be inoperable in a hot fire. Will be inoperable. Okay, so now let me switch to reliability. Reliability is really concerned with the entire weapon system operating as designed, meaning that the probability that the weapon detonates at the desired yield and target through its entire lifetime. So reliability is generally assessed jointly with the weapon delivery vehicle and a warhead, at least at some level. But our responsibility for sure is to assess the reliability of arming, fusing, and firing, which is the responsibility that Sandia has, but frequently this is done. So we do a reliability assessment that feeds into DoD. DoD does a weapon system reliability assessment, and that number is used when they do war planning. And this is important because if the number is too low, it would actually suggest you need more weapons, right? So we want this number to be very high so that for the purpose of war planning, there's as few nuclear weapons as part of that plan as possible. All right. Now, just you gotta geek out on reliability with me for a second, too. Reliability is often referred to, no matter what it is, and it's true of nuclear weapons too, something called a bathtub curve, so this blue curve. You tend to have issues at the beginning of the life that are called infant mortality, things that you design wrong or built wrong, and you need to find them early on. The middle tends to be okay, and then you get out towards the end of life and you get wear out failures or aging failures that you didn't anticipate. So it's really important for reliability that you find these things and you find these, but you pay some attention here. And this is done in a very, you might imagine statistically this is all quite complicated. So the way this works is, to get reliability, which is generally 90% or higher, we need to take conduct about 13 system level tests per year to meet this thing called the 90-10-2 requirement, which is within 2 years, any defect that would infect 10% of the population, we will find with 90% confidence. And so 13 system level tests along with a combination of lots of other things are done for each system on an annual basis. So let me just now security. So we did safety, reliability. Let me just touch on security. Real world security concerns. As you're aware, there are many different kinds. One was not too long ago in 2012, at the Y-12, where an 80-year-old nun, I love this picture, this 80-year-old nun, along with some of her colleagues, managed to get into Y-12 and right on the building. So that's kind of scary, and a lot of attention was paid to it. Another type of security concern things like, there was a coup in Turkey in July of 2016, it resulted in the loss of power to Incirlik Air Base, which is a NATO air base. That was concerning. And then transportation security is another kinds of security we worry about. So These weapons move a lot. The Office of Secure Transportation and DOE uses a statistic of 140 million miles of over-the-road experience since 1975. And then there was, of course, this incident of the B-52 being flown from Minot to Barksdale with, oops, nuclear weapons. But we thought they were trainers. So there are real concerns. Now, about security, the security of U.S. nuclear weapons is not assessed in the same manner. It's not part of the annual assessment. Instead, a joint DOD-DOE surety report is issued annually to the president, and the lead on that is the Assistant Secretary of NCB. So it's a different process. The security, and I won't talk about it again, but just so you know, the security of the weapons is both internal and external. Sandia, NNSA and Sandia is responsible for internal weapon security. By that, I mean if an adversary gets the weapon, some of these weapons have lots of protection inside, so even if you got it, you're not going to be able to, it's going to dud on you. But external weapon security, just making sure somebody doesn't get it, is the responsibility of whatever organization has custody of it. So it's the responsibility of DOE when they have custody, responsibility of DOD when they have custody. So Sandia and other labs and defense contractors support DOE and DOD in providing security for nuclear weapons wherever they are, but it's up to the individual organizations what that might be. Okay, so now back to safety and reliability. So the safety and reliability requirements often play off against one another. So we call this at Sandia, always never. It's pretty much the motto of the laboratory. They'll always work if requested. They will never work at any other time. So to do this, we generate these signals. There's a lot of claptrap to generate those signals. If this electromechanical device, which by the way is packaged in something that looks like that, if this electromechanical device would fail open, it would be a reliability concern. If it would fail closed, it would be a safety concern. And so these two things play off against one another. And the DOE is forever telling the DOD, we can make your weapons more safe and secure. And the DOD is always telling the DOE, maybe. But how much does it cost and how much harder is it going to be for us to maintain? Reasonable questions. It's good that we have the dialogue. In the end, the Nuclear Weapons Council makes decisions about safety, security, and use control issues for existing weapons and proposed new weapon program starts. We haven't done that for a while, and then ensuring adequate consideration is given to design, performance, and cost trade-offs when making those decisions. So here's how the assessment process works. It goes all the time. It's not, we write an annual letter. The assessment process is a continuous process. So the surveillance testing is done, and that's done at different times in the year for different systems. That work is analyzed, it's presented, it's written, it's presented to many people, including the DOD. It's reviewed by independent reviewers. I love doing this. I love the saw and the shower. Like, isn't this great that you can now just use clip art for independent review? And then all of that is taken into consideration, and a final letter is written, and the process basically begins again or continues. So here's a little bit more what it looks like. So we take these 13 random samples. Again, it's about 13, it depends, of each family of weapon systems. And they're sent back from the field to the Pantex plant. The nuclear physics packages are removed and replaced with instrumentation and ballast. And the physics package are either, this is actually a mistake, they're either non-destructively or destructively inspected for the physics lab to conduct their annual assessments. And Sandia uses the denuclearized weapon system for joint test assembly flight testing. The joint is for DOE, DOD, or system level lab and field testing. And then we, of course, you know, subject everything we can to the worst environments we can imagine and that we can generate and make sure things. So lightning, we have lightning generators I'll show you, fires, crush, everything else. This is both experimentally and analytically. And we cycle through hot and cold temperature extremes. And for most of the combined accident scenarios, they're really far too expensive to test, and we do more modeling on that. But just to show you, so this is a Pantex picture of preparing a denuclearized unit. This is from the stockpile stewardship plan, the NNSA stockpile stewardship plan, that shows you the number of things that are done. So JTA, these are the flight tests. In 2017, there were 21 done, planned in 1828. So you can see there's seven families, so about three each. So these are the surveillance flight tests, approximately three each of each family. ICBM, Minuteman launches are from Vandenberg to Kwajalein. SLBMs, the sub-launched star Trident missiles, are from in the South Atlantic. These are actual photographs of surveillance tests not too long ago. Bomb tests are at Tonopah Test Range or Utah Proving Grounds if it's a cruise missile. Utah's larger. Some tests actually have explosives. They never have a nuclear package, but some actually have explosives. And the data has to be collected from the explosives in the flight. And the labs have all sorts of diagnostics, including development of the instrumentation package that goes in place of the pit. And things float around to collect diagnostics that the labs design and use. System level field tests, so we also take these things and subject them to everything, as I mentioned. We have fire test complexes. That's a fire test. That's a centrifuge where you spin this thing really fast and make sure it can withstand all the environment. Drop them into water, slam them into walls. This is engineering, okay? This is the good stuff. And I've got subsystem and component testing, also all sorts of things. Let me just give you, this is a vibration table. You can see how instrumented it is. This is our Z machine that generates an electromagnetic environment, a radiation environment, to make sure that our microelectronics and other components can survive the kind of environment that you might see. This is actually a lightning generator, and of course some analysis. So many different things that are tested. And just to show you they're real, I cut pieces of video, so I'm not a video person, but I think you'll find this a real world thing. So. So as a lab director, I received about 100 hours of briefing on stockpile safety, reliability, and performance annually. And so each manager who had one of these systems in his or her organization would brief me about all the test results, all the significant findings, any changes in safety, reliability, or performance, and any concerns now or into the future. Then levels of managers above them would summarize any common issues, any trends, any things they see. The director of modeling and simulation would brief me, the director of material science, the red team lead, the independent nuclear weapon assessment team lead. I usually chose a couple of special topics to get briefings on. And then I also got life extension program summaries because it's the life extensions that really fix the problems over the long run. And this is actually Washington Post, but I think it's really good because it's a nice, you know, the bombs, the sub-based, the intercontinental cruise missile. And Sandia has to assess all of these. Lawrence Livermore and Los Alamos only have to assess the responsibilities they do the design for, but since we do the engineering for all of them. And then I wrote the letter. I you know, got on the computer, opened a document, and wrote a letter. And it took about 4 to 6 weeks to write. It was the most time I ever spent in town. That was the positive thing about it. It's largely dominated by results from each weapon system, so take all that information and boil it down to what really matters. There was an opportunity to report on new activities or trends, and then we briefed the letter to the NNSA administrator and the Secretary of Energy, the three of us together, the other two lab directors. The commander of STRATCOM and his or her staff were invited, and others from DOD sometimes were invited. Also to that meeting. And then I have to say, because I get asked all the time, the assessment results are really fully independent. This is really the way the process works. The responsibility to write the letter was a responsibility that started, that occurred every year and was done independently. And I even managed to get them to let me have the classified document in front of me when they took the picture. They had never done that before. They're like, we can't do that. typical weapon assessment. So here's what it was. We reported on the safety, any potential vulnerabilities, anything that's changed, anything that was going to be fixed by a life extension program, report on the reliability, if anything changed, whether it met the requirements, if anything has changed, even if it did meet the requirements. We discussed surveillance tests, and in particular, we're continuously improving surveillance, like extended range tests and so forth. We discussed red team and independent findings and significant investigations, so for each weapon system. Then the other sections that were required. The quote that I used in the letters I wrote was, underground testing is neither necessary nor preferred to resolve any issues identified in this assessment. The physics lab have slightly different ways they word that, but they also assessed that there was no need for underground testing. And the ability to resume testing, and I'll just say, I won't quote my letter, but I'll just say that in my judgment, the fact that there are active life extension programs really help assure that if we were directed to do underground testing, that it could be done, but it would be very different than the last time it was done. And then capability assessments, generally the capabilities were improving at a fairly rapid pace, although we were quite concerned about the manufacturing complex because it had been ignored to a great extent during and wasn't sort of recapitalized. New things reported on. Sandia reported on this thing we call nuclear enterprise assurance. That's a supply chain management for any components that we would buy, and cybersecurity issue. And then a new thing that has started to occur, actually very recently, is the availability of test hardware. So it's a lot of test hardware, right? You pull 13 units out, you fly three of each weapon system. And if the weapons are well beyond their intended life, at the time they're built, enough is built so you can do the surveillance. If they're well beyond that, you start running out of parts. And so then you have a new statistical basis that you have to try to establish and understand. So So this is actually beginning to be a real issue for some of the weapon systems that are well beyond their lifetimes. And it is important to understand because it also drives how many, even if you don't have very many of a certain type of weapon, you have to build extra, not just for a hedge against international relations, but actually to do this kind of reliability testing. We have been reporting on infrastructure concerns have been significant for a while. And I just say that the issue here is that starting in about 1995 until about 2012, the infrastructure investments went to new capabilities to certify the stockpile without underground testing. So things like the National Ignition Facility, DART, the Dual Axis Radiographic Hydrodynamic Test Facility at Los Alamos, Microsystems Facility at Sandia, High Performance Computing. So that's where the money went. The plants were downsized or had decreased in funding, the sites and the plants. The modernization program then came along and placed really high demands on the infrastructure because you need to do a lot. In addition to this testing, you have to certify these things initially. So you do a lot of these same tests to certify initially. And then the modernization program was the design and production part of that had to be prioritized over recapitalizing other facilities, especially things like offices and light labs. So it was a continuous discussion about what infrastructure investments were needed. And then I just, finally say there is some, concerns maybe. As looking forward, you have to think about, okay, what is going to be the nature of the U.S. stockpile? If we have nuclear weapons, what's going to be the nature? So what we're doing, I think as you all know, is we're taking old weapons past their life and going through each and every part. And here's a picture of kind of how many parts there are, and saying this is good for another 25 years, this isn't. This is good, this isn't. This one we're going to redesign, right? And then we put them back together with the old parts or the new parts, and we say, that's a life-extended weapon. And so the question really is then just, in, as a thought exercise, is how long will that approach work? Another 25 years, 50 years, 100 years? I mean, assuming that we have nuclear weapons. And so it's just, I think, an issue that we were beginning to think about. And so then this is my last slide. So it's just sort of key messages. The U.S. really did have an incredible foresight to assign responsibility for designing and building nuclear weapons in a civilian agency. And the system really does work to allow DOE to propose safety security improvements and to begin a dialogue about what's the best thing to do. And the system will be very important for ensuring the safety and reliability for lower numbers of nuclear weapons. And I have to say that the safety and reliability assessments require specialized people and equipment and could not be recreated easily on demand. So it's part of what we have to think about in terms of nascent nuclear weapon capabilities. The annual assessment is a significant and serious task at the NNSA labs. After 23 cycles, and by the way, these are referred to as cycles, so you have to say, what did the cycle 21 letter say? But after 23 cycles, it continues to improve and is taken very seriously. New thoughts must be and are considered. And I would just say the detail involved is second to none. Thank you. I'm happy to take questions.